Okay, so let's start our today's session. In the previous class, we had an orientation session and we discussed a course outline. I hope you remember. We discussed that what will be the structure of the paper and we discussed about the course structure. Okay.
Yeah.
So the key areas which we have to cover included financial management, cost accounting, and I discussed my approach that after each step, after each subtopic, we'll be going towards the past papers. Okay. So we are starting with the financial management area today. Financial management area today, we will be discussing basic investment appraisal. And then once investment appraisal is done, we'll go for the past papers relating to investment appraisal. Then we'll go for VAC. We'll discuss its past papers. And in this way, we will proceed. Okay.
So after each lesson, I won't make notes now, but I'll make my own notes from your lesson afterwards. Yeah.
Yeah, you can make it during the lesson also, but just write brief points. Don't copy your entire lecture. Okay. So today we are starting the first area of the financial management, and that is investment appraisal. Okay. So in investment appraisal, basically we have different investment appraisal techniques. You must have studied them in your past exams of financial management. So we will revise all the investment appraisal techniques in like 2-3 classes. The objective will be that you have a complete revision of these techniques of investment appraisal, because when you will see in your SVM paper, you should be familiar with them. Okay. Now, investment appraisal projects. In order to evaluate investment projects, different techniques are used. In order to evaluate investment projects, different evaluation techniques are used. Investment projects, different evaluation techniques are used. Okay. Now, some of the techniques are very basic and you must remember them when we'll be studying them. Different evaluation techniques are used. Like, for example, we use net present value technique, NPV technique, basic net present value technique. We use adjusted present value technique. Have you studied adjusted present value in your past exams?
I would have done. I just don't remember.
Okay. I hope that net present value you must remember. That was very easy technique. But adjusted present value, we make financing adjustments in that. Okay. The third technique is IRR, internal rate of return. That was a very easy technique. IRR technique, a simple formula. Okay. Then one technique is payback period.
And so you'll go through each one quickly.
We will go through each technique. We'll discuss the questions on them. Obviously, the first two techniques will take greater time. Last three techniques are pretty much easier, so they don't take much time. But first two techniques will take a bit of time because we have to discuss foreign projects also. You need to understand how you have to deal with foreign currencies. So in foreign projects, you have to deal with direct quote, indirect quote, translation issues. So usually the student gets stuck in that. Okay. So we'll revise them all. Like you can estimate that in investment appraisal, like 4-5 meetings will be consumed in which we will discuss these techniques. So we are starting with a basic investment appraisal technique, which is net present value technique. Okay.
Yeah.
Now in net present value technique, what we do is that we simply calculate the present value of inflows and outflows. And if the net present value of the project is positive, then we accept the project. And if the net present value of the project is negative, then we obviously decline it. But in net present value technique, there are certain set of assumptions which we use. Okay. Like if the cash flows occur during the year, if cash flows occur at the start of the year, we have to deal with capital allowance adjustment, working capital adjustment. So what I'm doing is that usually my students do that they just take out the printout of my documents and they are also sufficient as the exam notes. Maybe you will not be required to write them again because my class notes will also be sufficient, because what I do is that I write all the rules on one sheet of exam. Like if I'm using this workbook, then I'll be solving the question, I'll be solving it on a separate sheet. I'll try to write down all the rules on one side so that you can easily use them in your examination. Okay, because I teach students specifically for their preparation of SBM so that it can be useful for them. Okay, so present value of all inflows, present value of all inflows and outflows is calculated. Of all inflows and outflows of project is calculated, and then decision is taken, and then decision is taken by netting them off, and then decision is taken by netting them off. Okay, now if NPV is positive, just a minute.
Is your rain stopped now?
Yeah. RCD is now back to normal. Just a minute. Yes. If NPV is positive, then project is accepted. Okay, now obviously this is some basic level knowledge, because we have started a topic, so we have to go through basic and advanced knowledge both. And if NPV is negative, then project is rejected. Okay, now I hope you remember that if the cash flows occur during the year, if the cash flows of the project occur during the year, we assume them as occurred at the end of the year, because the discount factors which we use are of end period. So like if a sale is made in the seventh month, we don't discount it at the seventh month. We discount it as assuming as it happened at the end of the year. Okay. And if the cash flow occurs at the start of the year, we assume that it happened at the end of the previous year. Because in order to calculate its present value, more accuracy will be achieved if we consider it as one at the previous year end, rather than taking it to the end of this year. Okay. Well, okay. Like for example, in January 2001, if we have incurred any inflow or an outflow, we will assume that it has happened at 31st December 2000, rather than taking it to 31st December 2001. Because in order to calculate present value, we use the discount factors, and discount factors are of end of the year, not of the during the year periods. Okay. Then you must remember that only relevant cash flows are considered, like sunk cost of the project is not considered. Okay. Any cost which was already committed, like fixed cost which was already committed, we don't consider it in project appraisal. Okay. Only relevant cash flows are considered. Only relevant cash flows are considered, okay, which are relevant to the project. Sunk cost is not considered. Sunk cost is ignored. So similar. Sunk cost means the cost which was already incurred. Like for example, the project research cost is a sunk cost because it will never be recovered, even if you start the project or you don't start it. Similarly, notional cost is not considered. Like depreciation is a notional cost.
Yeah,
we don't consider notional cost. Similarly, already committed cost, existing committed costs are not considered. Like for example, if I've already taken some place on a rent, irrespective of the project, existing committing costs, committed costs are not considered. Okay.
Yep.
So this is some basic knowledge, which obviously, once you have revised, you remember in the exam, and as the exam is open book, so you don't need to worry, because you will have all this information available with you during the exam. Okay. Cash flows incurred during the year are assumed as incurred during the year are assumed as happened or are assumed as incurred at end of year. Okay, because the discount factors we have are of end of year.
Yeah.
As incurred at end of year. Then similarly, cash flows incurred at start of year. Incurred at start of year are assumed as incurred. Are assumed as incurred at end of previous year. Okay.
Yep.
Now, do you remember what about the cash flows which were incurred at the start of the project?
Then obviously, yeah, then you assume they've taken place of last year.
No. At the start of the project, cash flow incurred at the start of the project, not the start of the incurred at start of the project. We show them as incurred at year zero. And okay, in year zero, we use discount factor as one.
One year.
Okay. So cash flows incurred at start of year are assumed as incurred at end of previous year. Now one is start of year and one is cash flows incurred at start of project.
Okay. Sorry, I got confused. Start. Okay. You've already written start of year. Yeah.
So, one is start of year and one is start of project.
Basically year zero.
Are shown as incurred in year zero. Year zero means now.
Yeah.
Are shown as incurred in year zero. That is now. Okay. Discount factor of year zero is one. Okay. Discount factor of year zero is one. Now, what do you mean by one? One means that present value and the future value will be same. Discount factor of year zero is one. Okay. So these are some basic assumptions. What I'm doing is that I'm writing all the basic assumptions first, and then I'll do some questions with you so that your knowledge will get revised and you will have a complete study approach of solving an NPV question. Okay. Similarly, in order to calculate present value of cash flows, discount factors are used. Okay. Now, do you remember NUT factors?
Yes, I use.
You must be using in your office also, in your work also.
Work as well, I used, yeah. It's basically when there's cash flows consistent, it's the same cash flow year
over
year,
a certain period of time.
NUT factor, yeah.
One divided by one plus R power N is the formula of the discount factor. You will have the discount factor sheet. I'll give you this discount factor sheet. You will simply take out its printout. You have it also?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. In order to calculate present value of cash flows.
I used it.
Okay. So what we were discussing about present value table I showed, and then some connectivity issue happened. So let's resume again. So in order to calculate present value, I'm writing down some basic issues also on this sheet. Maybe you know them in advance, but the reason of writing them down is that you will use it as your exam handout. So you need to have some rules together at one place. In order to calculate present value of cash flows, which are consistent over certain period of time, NUT factors are used. Okay. Then I hope you also remember that when we have to calculate the present value of cash flows, which will remain consistent forever, we use perpetuity factor. NUT factors are used. Okay. For cash flows which will remain consistent forever, per PG factor are used.
Perpetuity. So basically meaning, it's an infinity number of years.
Yeah, infinity number of years, which will remain consistent forever. Then perpetuity factors are used. Forever, then perpetuity factors are used. Okay. What is the formula of perpetuity? 1 divided by discount factor. 1 divided by interest rate, basically the discount rate. Perpetuity factor. 1 divided by interest rate. Okay, like for example, if interest rate is 10%, we simply use 1 divided by 10%. So that gives us the perpetuity factor. Okay. If the perpetuity cash flows will grow, if the perpetuity factor will grow, then we use a different formula. Perpetuity with growth. Then what do we do?
So you're meaning if the cash flows grow, yeah?
Yeah. If it is written that the cash flows will continue in the perpetuity, but they will grow at certain rate, then what you will do, you will simply cash flow into 1 plus growth divided by interest rate minus growth rate.
Okay. Yeah.
So the basic objective of writing down these formulas on one place is that you can remember them in your exam, and this will help you and act as a formula sheet for you. Okay.
Yeah.
So cash flow into 1 divided by interest rate, you'll get present value of perpetuity. Basically, I'll change it as present value of perpetuity. One divided by interest rate and perpetuity with growth, you will 1 plus growth, and from denominator, you will remove growth rate from the interest rate. Okay. Because the basic reason is that some portion of your cost of capital will be financed through the growth rate. So we remove the growth rate percentage from our cost of capital. Okay. Then you need to remember if there is any working capital investment, so we need to have working capital investment at the start of the year. And the general assumption is that working capital investment will be recovered at the end of the project. Okay. So working capital investment can include investment in inventory, investment in debtors and things like that. Okay. Working capital investments will be required at start of year. Like sometimes it is a one-off working capital investment and sometimes it is incremental working capital investment, which is a percentage of sales.
Yeah.
Okay. Working capital investment is required at start of year.
Yeah.
Is required at start of each year. Okay. Then it is assumed that working capital investment will be recovered. It is assumed that working capital investment will be recovered at end of project. Okay. Then what you need to remember is investment will be recovered at end of project.
Yeah.
Okay. Then you need to remember that capital allowances are used for calculating the tax. Capital allowances are calculated. Remember? Capital allowances are calculated for tax calculations. Capital allowances are considered for tax calculations. Okay. Then, or tax calculation. Then you must remember about Fisher effect, the nominal discount rate and the real discount rate. Okay.
Yeah.
If inflated cash flows are used, are used in NPV calculation, in NPV calculation, then nominal interest rate is used. Do you remember?
No, I don't remember this.
The nominal interest rate is used.
NPV calculation. So when you say inflated cash flows.
Inflated means that we will consider inflation in the cash flows. Like, for example, year one, year two, year three, year four, I will consider the impact of inflation. Like if there is yearly inflation.
Okay.
Then, if inflated cash flows are used in NPV calculation, then nominal interest rate is used for calculation of discount factor. For calculation of discount factor. And if you have ignored the inflation factor, then you use real rate. Now, there was a concept of Fisher's effect, which explained the relation between the nominal interest rate and the real interest rate. Real interest rate ignores the impact of inflation, whereas nominal interest rate includes the impact of inflation rate. I will repeat it again. If you are considering the cash flows which are uninflated, this means that if you are ignoring the impact of the inflation, then you will use real interest rate, which do not include the impact of inflation.
Yeah.
Okay. If inflation factor is ignored.
And this will be stated, won't it?
It will be stated. If inflation factor is ignored, then real interest rate will be used. Real interest rate will be used for discount factor calculation. For discount factor calculation. Okay?
Yeah.
There is an equation of Fisher's effect. Fisher's effect equation explains relation between nominal interest rate and real interest rate. Nominal interest rate is one which includes the impact of inflation. Nominal interest rate, which includes impact of inflation, and real interest rate. Now, what is the equation? 1 plus n is equal to 1 plus r plus 1 plus I. Now, basically, n is the nominal interest rate.
Yeah.
N is the nominal interest rate, which includes the impact of inflation.
Yeah. R is real.
R is real interest rate, which do not include impact of inflation.
Yeah.
And I is the inflation rate. Okay, so what I have done is that I have written down some basic assumptions or I would say some basic calculation perspective things of net present value calculation, because these will be useful when you will calculate NPV, and these will also be used when you will calculate adjusted present value. Okay, so in investment appraisal, we discuss different techniques through which we evaluate the projects. One is net present value, one is adjusted present value, IRR, and all these. So we have started our first technique and we have discussed some basic rules of NPV, that we consider relevant cash flows. We consider cash flows during the year as incurred at the end of the year. Start of the year are considered as incurred at the start of the end of the previous year. Start of the project means year zero. Discount factor, annuity factor, perpetuity factor, capital allowances. So these are some basic knowledge which you need to have before we move towards some NPV questions. Okay. So now what I'm doing is, now this is the discount factor table. Okay. You will take it with yourself in the examination. And this is the annuity factor table.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, what we are doing is that we are doing some basic questions of financial management. And these are not of your SVM course. These are basically some basic financial management questions so that you can have some, clarity on this net present value. We'll do these 3-4 basic questions and then we'll move towards another technique.
All right.
Okay, so now the name of question is Tricor Company. Let's look at it. Tricor Company plans to buy a new machine to meet expected demand for a new product, product T. This machine will cost $2,50,000. Now this will be your initial investment and last for 4 years. At the end of which time it will be sold for $5,000. This will be your scrap value. Tricor Company expects demand for product T to be as follows. Demand units 35,000, 40,000, 50,000 and 25,000. The selling price for product T is expected to be $12 per unit and variable cost is expected to be $7.8 per unit. Incremental annual fixed production overhead is $25,000 per year. Selling price and cost are all in current price terms. Always remember, current price terms means year zero.
Okay.
Now, okay. Selling price and cost are expected to increase as follows. Now, selling price will increase each year by 3%. Variable cost will increase each year by 4%. And fixed production overhead will increase by 6% each year.
Yeah.
Okay. Tricor Company has real cost of capital of 5.7%. Now, real cost of capital means the one which is uninflated one.
Yeah.
Okay. And these cash flows... Now, these are the inflation rates. Now, when I will inflate the cash flows, I want the nominal rate.
Okay.
Pays tax at annual rate of 30%, 1 year in arrear. 1 year in arrear means that this year tax will be paid in the next year. It can claim capital allowances at 25% reducing balance basis. General inflation is expected to be 5% per year. Okay.
Yep.
Tricor Company has target return on capital employed of 20% and depreciation is charged on straight line basis. We are going for part A in which we will calculate the net present value. Okay. Now this is not an SVM question, but this will give us an idea of net present value, which we have just discussed, and it will revise your previous old knowledge.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's do this question. A good past revision. Tricor Company net present value. Okay. Now, the life of the machine is how many years?
4 years.
The life of the machine is 4 years. One thing which you need to remember is that tax is paid 1 year in arrears. So the fourth year tax will be paid in fifth year. Okay,
yep.
So we'll make an analysis of how many years, year zero, which is now, year one, year two, year three, year four, and year five. Okay, year zero is now, year one, two, three, four, and five. Okay. Okay, so resuming again, some connectivity issue happened. So we made 5 years, year zero, year one, year two, year three, year four, year five. Okay. Year zero denominates now the start of the project in which we will purchase a machine at a cost of $2,50,000. Okay. Now, there is demand of 35,000, 40,000 units. 50,000 units and 25,000 units. Now here, what you need to understand is that I always say to my students that try to solve operational cash flows first and then put the investments, because you have to calculate the tax on operational cash flows. Now, operational.
When you say operational, you mean the
sales,
demand.
Variable cost, fixed cost, the cash flows on which the tax will be charged. On investment, there will be no tax. On working capital investment, there will be no tax. On scrap value, there will be no tax. Okay. So always try to solve the operational cash flows first. So what I'm doing is that first of all, I will put up the operational cash flows. Okay. So now it includes the sales. Now, if you look at the sales, there is demand of 35,000 units, 40,000 units, 50,000 units, and 25,000 units. Okay. Yeah. The selling price is $12, and it will increase by 3% per year. What I'm doing is that I'm taking the picture of this page so that I don't have to change the screen again and again. And I will keep it in front of me. Okay. Now, and we will make a schedule here that the sales units are 35,000, 40,000, 50,000, and 25,000. But first of all, what we need to do is that we need to estimate the yearly selling price because it will be inflated every year. Okay. Yeah. So I'm making some workings. Workings, working one. Now, selling price. Year 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4.
So £12 in year 0?
Yeah. $12 in year 0, and then it will get inflated by 3% per year. Okay?
So it'll increase to 12.36?
12.36, then?
Then...
12.73,
then 13.11,
then 13.51. Now this is the place where computer-based exams can be really useful, because solving them on the computer software on a spreadsheet will be useful for you.
I heard you like the software. I think the software is useless.
No, in some places it is useful, but majority it's useless. But like here where you have to use the formulas, the software can be really useful, because using the calculator then is not pretty much easy. Or it, I would say it wastes time. On spreadsheet, you can save this portion of time. Okay. Now, if you talk about variable cost, the variable cost element is the variable cost of the production is expected to be $7.8 per unit, and it will increase by 4% per year. So, variable cost $7.8. So, if you inflate it by 4% per year,
8.11.
8.11, 8.43,
8.43,
8.77, and 9.12. Okay, and then about the fixed cost, it's $25,000, if I'm not wrong. The fixed cost is $25,000 per year, and it will increase by 6% per year.
Yeah.
So 25,000 is equal to into 1.06. So it's 26,500. Then it will be 28,090. Yeah. Then it will be
29,775.
Yes.
Finally, 31,562.
Okay, so these are, you made a small working, and now if you look at the number of units, so your number of units are 35,000, 40,000, 50,000, and 25,000. Yeah. So let's start putting the sales. 35,000 units multiplied by your selling price, which is 12.36. So what will be your sales?
Okay, so you're doing, okay. So
then 40,000 units multiplied by 12.73 is the selling price. Okay, then 50,000 units, and your selling price is 13.11.
Yep.
in year four it is 25,000 units multiplied by 13.51.
Yep, should I give you the numbers?
Yes.
56. The first one is 432,600.
432,600. Okay.
12.7.73 is 509,200.
509,200.
Yep. 13.11. 655,500.
Okay. And 337,750. Okay. So this is my sales. Now, then there will be variable cost.
Yep.
Simply you will start multiplying it with variable cost 35,000. Your variable cost amount is 8.11, 8.43, 8.77, and 9.12. So 35,000 multiplied by 8.11, then 40,000 units multiplied by 8.43.
So you don't do anything for year zero, innit, obviously.
Obviously, because in year zero there will be no sale. Year zero means now. Okay.
Yep.
And then 25,000 units multiplied by 9.12.
Yep.
Okay, so you'll get the variable cost element 35,000 into 8.11. So this gives me 283,850.
You're right, yep.
Then
337. 200.
200. Then
438,500.
438,500. And then 228,000. Okay. So this is the sales variable cost. And then we put the fixed cost element.
Yep.
So our fixed cost is, it's simply 26,500, 28,090. 26,500, 28,090, 29,775. And then 31,562.
Yeah.
Okay. So now what you have done is that you have just recorded the operational cash flows. Okay. Like sales, variable cost, fixed cost. Okay. Now what you will include is that you will put the impact of capital allowances in it. Now the question is that is the capital allowance a relevant cash flow? My question to you is that is capital allowance a relevant cash flow? Tell me. Yes or no? Okay. Okay, so what I was asking that is capital allowance a relevant cash flow?
No.
So why do we consider it while calculating NPV?
It's a good question. I don't know.
Basically, we are just including it for the calculation of the tax because the tax authorities allow capital allowance. We will deduct the capital allowance, we will calculate the tax, and then we will reverse the capital allowance amount. Okay? Because in an investment appraisal, we only consider relevant cash flows. So the investment amount, like here in this case, the $2,50,000 investment is a relevant cash flow, which will be entirely shown in the year zero. Because now, if I consider the investment and I consider capital allowances also, it will be double count.
Okay? Yeah, okay.
But tax department will not consider the entire investment together. They will consider it through concept of capital allowances. Okay. Now, what is the capital allowance concept they have given? They have given 25% reducing balance basis. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, so for calculation of capital allowance, what we'll do is that they have given 25% reducing balance basis. So year 1, year 2, year 3, and year 4, net book value, and then you will get the capital allowance. So if you have purchased a machine of $2,50,000, so obviously at the start of the year, the net book value will be 250, and you have to take capital allowance on 25% reducing balance, RDB. So 250,000 into 0.25, the allowance will be $62,500. Okay. Now your net book value will be 1,87,500. So now 25% of it, 46,875.
Yep, 46,875. Yep.
So now the net book value will be 140,625. Now again, 25% of it,
3,516.
Okay. Now your net book value is 140,625. Now in the last year, obviously you get the balancing allowance. Do you remember the balancing allowance? The remaining net book value will become the capital allowance. Okay. Now the scrap value of the machine is $5,000. When you will sell this machine, you'll get $5,000. So the remaining net book value, like how will I calculate it? 105,468 minus $5,000.
Yeah.
So it will be $100,468. Now this will be your balancing allowance. Okay. I hope you are understanding it. Now these all are the issues which you have studied in your past exams. What we are doing is we are simply revising them. Obviously, if you remember your basic financial management, you study net present value in 6-7 classes. But today we will study entire net present value in one class. So we will try to revise each and every adjustment which you have studied in past. Okay. So capital allowance 62,500. The second capital allowance is 46,875.
Yeah.
The third capital allowance is 35,156. And the last one is 100,468. Now what I will get is, now that will be called as taxable profits. Since I have deducted the capital allowances, I will call it as taxable profits on which I will charge the tax. Okay. So please help me out in calculating it.
Oh, sure. Yeah. 432,600. I'll do first number year one. You can do the next.
59,750. Positive?
Positive.
655,500 minus 438,500 minus 29,775. Minus 35,156. So 152,069. And second one is
97,035. Positive.
Positive. So now we will charge the tax. Now what is the tax percentage? The tax percentage is 30% and it is 1 year in arrears. Okay. So let's charge tax. No tax in year zero and no tax in year one.
Yeah.
Okay, because it's 1 year in. 59,750 into 0.3 is?
It's 17,925.
Okay, so it will appear in year two. because it will be paid 1 year in arrears.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Then 29110 152069 into 0.3.
45620.
45620 and 222280 into 0.3. It's positive 6684 because it's a tax loss.
Oh,
okay. Yeah. Now this is one more thing which you need to understand. Now it is a loss in the last year, so I took a refund. If it would have been a loss in the first year, I would not have taken a refund. Rather, I would have carried forward the loss and I would have offset against the second year profits.
Ah, tax losses. Yeah.
Okay. So now that is very important. Now, as it was the loss in the last year, so I took the refund simply.
You took the tax credit.
Yeah, because we assume that we will have profits in other projects of the company.
Yeah.
Okay. Now what we will do is that we will take reversal of capital allowance. We will simply reverse the capital allowance because it was not a relevant cash flow. Okay. 62,500. We only deducted it for tax calculations. 46875. 35156 and 100468. Okay. I hope that you are understanding it. Now, once I'm done with the tax, now I'm free. I can put any cash flow now. Now I will put the investment of machine. Now investment of machine was $250,000 in year zero.
So you only do the tax on the relevant cash flows, yeah?
No. On operational cash flows. Investment is also a relevant cash flow.
But on you do that. You're not going to charge tax on that, that's why.
Yeah. On scrap value, there will obviously be no tax. Scrap value will be recovered at the end of the project, which was $5,000. Okay. Yeah. Now, this question did not include any working capital investments. Now, I will make you through 2-3 questions in which we will consider incremental working capital, one-off working capital, recovery of working capital, so that you can revise all of the adjustments. Okay.
Yeah.
Now that this number which we will get will be called as net cash flows. Okay. Net cash flows. So net cash flows of year zero are negative 250,000. Then 59750 plus 62500, so it's 122,250. 97035 minus 17925 plus 46875, so it's 125985. 152069 minus 29110. Plus 35156, so it's 158,115, and then 22280 minus 45620 plus 100468 plus 5000.
37568.
Yep. And 6684. Okay. Now we have to put the discount factor. Now, for discount factor, we need the interest rate. Now, as the cash flows were inflated, so we need nominal interest rate. Okay, we need nominal interest rate because nominal, we inflated.
Nominal includes inflation.
Inflation rate, yes. Nominal includes the inflation rate. Okay. Now in the question, the real interest rate was, where is it? Yes. Real cost of capital was 5.7% and the inflation rate was 5%.
Yeah.
Okay. So 5.7 is the real rate and inflation rate is 5%. So 1 plus N is equal to 1 plus R plus 1 plus I. Okay. So the Fisher effect multiplied by 1 plus I. So 1 plus n is equal to 1 plus
5.7%
multiplied by 1 plus 5%. Okay, so can you calculate it?
Yeah.
1 plus 0.057 multiplied by 1 plus 0.05
equals 1
minus 1. So the nominal rate will be 10.985%. Have you done with it or shall I calculate it? Okay, let's calculate it. Let's calculate it. Now see, 1 plus n is equal to, this will be 1.057, because 5.7% means 0.057 multiplied by 1.05.
Yeah.
Okay, so 1 plus n is equal to 1.057.
1.10.
So this will be 1.1025. Okay? Now n will be 1.1025 minus 1. Because when you will shift the 1, so n will be
0.1025. Yeah.
Okay, basically I think I calculated it wrong. So I can call it as 10.25% if I'll multiply it with the 100.
Yeah.
Okay, so 10.25% is the discount factor. Now, it is your choice. If you want it, you can use it as 10%. Or if you want accuracy, you can calculate the discount factor of 10%, or 10.25% also if you want accuracy. Otherwise, what the examiner normally do is that he simply round it off. 909-826-751-683-621 will be the discount factors. So
0.909.826.751.683.621.
Okay.
So you did ACCA or ACA?
I did both.
You did both?
Yeah, I did both. First I qualified ACCA and then I did ACA.
Ah, so in Pakistan you still have to have a contract and stuff, right?
Yeah, I did my training period in ICI Pakistan Limited. First, I worked in Ernst & Young for some period, and then my ICW contract was completed in ICI Pakistan Limited.
Oh, okay. Good.
So here comes the present values. 250,000. 122.
Is...
It will triple be
125.
125985 into 0.826. So it will be 104063. 158115 into 0.751. So it will be 118744. 37568 into 0.683. 25658.
Last one is 4150.
4150. So you will get your NPV. 111125 plus 104063 plus 118744 plus 25658 plus 4150 minus 250,000. So it's 113740, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah.
Okay. So now if you look at this question, I always say to my students is that obviously a student at SBM level will never consider it difficult. It is simply a revision of his past knowledge. But obviously, it has been a long time he has studied financial management. So he has forgotten some basic operational level workings. Okay. Yeah. Now, so in this question, we basically revised our inflation adjustments. We revised our working of capital allowance. We looked at how we have to deal with inflation. Okay. The basic formulas which I discussed with you. Okay. I think I wrote plus sign here. It's a multiply sign. Okay. We discussed that how we have to calculate the NPV. Now it was a basic question. It was not a difficult question. We did some basic adjustments. Now, similarly, if you look at one more question, now in this question, we will have a working capital adjustment. Similarly, yeah. I have extracted like four questions of basic financial management and we have to calculate NPV. And all of these four questions involve different types of adjustments. Okay. So we will look at two, three questions and then I'll give you one question as a homework so that you can do it on your own so that you can have a brief review. Obviously, it is not a technical question. These are not technical questions. So you may feel easy. Okay. Now let's look at one more question. SC company. SC company is evaluating the purchase of a new machine to produce product P, which has a short product life cycle due to rapidly changing technology. The machine is expected to cost $1 million. Production and sales are forecast to be as follows. Now, the investment of the machine, $1 million, it is year zero investment. Okay. Production and sale units are 35,000, 53,000, 75,000, and 36,000 units. The selling price will be $20 per year, while variable cost will be $12 per unit. Okay, $20 per unit and $12 per unit. Selling price inflation is 4% and variable cost inflation is 5%. Okay, no increase in fixed cost is expected since SC company has spare capacity in both space and labor terms. The fixed cost will not be incurred, no relevant fixed cost.
Yep.
Production and selling of product P will call for increased investment in working capital. Analysis of historical level of working capital within SC company indicate that at the start of each year, investment in working capital will be 7% of sales revenue. Now, this is what we call as incremental working capital approach. Yeah. That we need to have 7% of the sales revenue. So we need to add some amount in working capital each year. Okay. Now this will be the new learning in this question. SC company pays tax at 30% in the year in which the profit occurs. Now, there is no arrears. We pay tax in the same year. Liability to tax is reduced by capital allowances, which SC company claim on straight line basis. The previous question was of reducing balance. Now we'll have straight line over 4 year life for the proposed investment. The new machine is expected to have no scrap at the end of 4 years.
Yeah.
Nominal cost of capital is 20%. Okay. Mm-hmm. So you are provided with nominal cost of capital. You don't need to convert anything.
So nominal is obviously has.
Nominal is the inflated one. So again, we'll calculate the net present value of the project. Okay, so let's look at it again, some basic revision and then one more new learning, which is of incremental working capital. Okay, again, let's look at it. SC company. Net present value. Okay. 4 year analysis, year zero, year one, year two, year three, and year four. Now this time there is no arrears.
Yeah.
Okay. Again, what I will do is that first of all, I will consider the operational cash flows, the cash flows on which the tax implications will arise. Okay.
Yeah.
I hope that you're not getting bored. Okay. Don't worry about it. These are the starting days of SBM. With passage of time, there will be no such days.
No, it's good. It's good. Okay. I'm still exhausted from my exam on Monday. That's why.
So, defer the exam till next July. So you will have plenty of the time.
No.
So, let's look at sales first of all. 35,000, 53,000 units, 75 and 36,000. But first of all, we have to calculate the inflated selling price and variable cost, $20 and $12. And Inflation is 4% for selling price and 5% for variable cost. So let's make an analysis again.
So we'll be able to do this all for the exam in November, won't we? I need to sit this in November.
Sorry?
We'll be able to aim for November exam, won't we?
Yeah, we will be able to do it. Don't worry about it.
Yeah. I have no choice. I need to finish exams.
Yeah. Just we need punctuality and consistency.
Of course.
Year 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So the selling price is $20 and variable cost is $12. Okay, so let's start calculating it. Selling price inflation is 4% and variable cost inflation is 5%. So first of all, let's complete the selling price.
So selling price one is 4%, yeah?
Yes. So 20 is equal to into 1.04. 20.8. Then
21.6. 22.5 and 23.4.39.
So I would write it 3, and then 12 into 1.05 is the inflation for variable cost. Okay, 12.6, 13.23,
yeah,
then 13.9.
Yeah.
Or 13.89 and then 14.56. Okay.
5.8.
So this is the selling price and the variable cost. Okay. So number of units, 35,000, 53,000, 75,000, and 36,000. 35,000 units multiplied by 20.8 dollars. So this will give me the sales. Then the second year units are 53,000 multiplied by the selling price is 21.6.
Yep.
Okay. Then I think the units are 75,000 and then 36,000.
Yeah.
75,000 units multiplied by 22.5. And 36,000 units multiplied by 23.3. Okay, so let's calculate the sales.
Yep.
23.3. The last year sales are 838,800. Then 75,000 into 22.5. It's 1,687,500.
The first one is 728,000, by the way.
Sorry?
Year one, 728,000.
728,000.
Yep.
And then 53 into 21.6. So it's 1,144,800. Okay. So then we will have the variable cost. Okay, so some clerical level work, 35,000 multiplied by variable cost is 12.6.
13.23, next one.
How much?
13.23.
What's this? Then it was 13.89. And the last one is 14.58.
Mm.
Okay. Now there is no fixed cost in the question. Into 12.6. It's 4,41,000. Then 53,000 into 13.23. It's 701,190. 75,000 into 13.89. It's 1,041,750.
And the last one is 524,880.
880. Don't you think it's too much? 36,000 into 14.58. It's 524,880. Okay, sorry. So we have the sales, we have the variable cost. It was stated in the question that there will be no increase in the fixed cost as the company has spare capacity. Okay. Yes. So just what we need to include is the capital allowances so that we can reach the taxable profits. Okay. So there is no scrap value in the question.
Yeah.
$1 million is the cost of investment, and the capital allowances will be claimed on straight line basis. Yes, here it is, straight line basis, and there are 4 years. So simple capital allowance working. Capital allowances. $1 million.
That's what the investment.
And straight line basis over 4 years. Okay. And no scrap value.
So what do you do capital? You do capital allowance on the initial investment.
Yeah. On the machine value. Because if he's silent, we assume that the amount we are investing is in the machine. Again, we'll get capital allowance on it. But in advanced questions, once I'll move towards adjusted present value, there will be questions that there will be some investment in the land on which there will be no capital allowance, and some investment will be on machine. And because since it is the first class, I'm doing basic questions with you in which there is only investment is in machine. Okay. So, no scrap value. Now, so $1 million divided by 4 years. So, this will give me $250,000 per year.
Yeah.
Okay. It's 250, 250, 250, and 250. Okay, so now I'll get my taxable profits. Taxable profits, 0. 728,000 minus 441 minus 250. So it's 37,000.
Yeah.
Oh, 1,144,800 minus 701,190 minus 250,000.
So 193,610.
610,168,750 minus 1,041,750 minus 250,000. So 395,750. Okay.
Last one is 63,920.
Positive, negative?
Positive.
Positive. Okay. So now we will charge the tax. Now, what is the tax amount? SC company pays tax at 30% per year.
Yep.
Okay.
Carry on. I'm just getting a charger for the laptop.
Yeah. So 0. 37,000 into 0.3, it's 11,100. 193,610 into 0.3 is 58,083. Then 395,750 into 0.3 is 118,725 and then 63,920 into 0.3 is 19,176. Okay. And then I hope you remember from the previous question also that we reverse the capital allowance.
Yes.
Because it is not a relevant cash flow. Yeah. 250, 250, 250, and 250. Okay.
Yep. Yep.
So now we are done with the tax. And now the thing we have to look at it are the investments. So the initial investment which we will make is $1 million, which is in year zero.
Yep.
Now the most important thing for which we are doing this question, that is working capital. Now in this question, the working capital assumption is analysis of historical levels of working capital within SC company indicates that the start of each year investment in working capital for product P will be 7% of the sales revenue. Okay, the working capital investment will be 7% of the sales revenue. Okay, so we have to calculate working capital incremental investment each year. Now this is thing which you need to understand. Now look at it, working capital. Okay, now basically year zero, year one, year two, year three, year four. Now these are your years. Now basically this is the sale, 7,28,000.
Yeah.
How much working capital do you need? You need working capital of 7% of sales.
Yeah, so we just 7 times it by 7%.
728,000. Now, if you look at it carefully, what I'm doing is, that I picked up year one sale, and on the basis of which I will invest working capital at year zero, because we need working capital investment at the start of year.
Also, you picked up sales of year one.
Year one. And through that, I will calculate working capital investment for year zero, because I need working capital investment at the start of the year. Start of year means end of previous year. You didn't get the point? I need working capital investment at the start of the year.
Okay, so
start of year one means year zero. Start of year two means year one. Start of year three means year two. Start of year four means year three.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The start of year means end of previous year. We will show that cash flow at the previous year. Now, let's look at how much NPV you remember. 50,960 is the working capital I need at year zero. Now, my sales for year two are 11,448,000.
Times 7%.
11,448,000 into 7%. How much is it?
81,36.
Now, if you look at it, we already have 50,960 invested. So we will invest the incremental amount only. Okay. Because if I have already some working capital, why I will invest the whole of the amount?
So when you say working capital, what does
working
that mean?
Capital means the inventory surplus, the receivable balances. Working capital means the running cash flow which you need to hold.
Yeah.
So considering the sale, you need 7% amount. Now that is 80,136. 50,960 is already invested in the working capital. So you will only invest the incremental amount.
Got it.
Okay. So 29,176. Now you need this working capital for year two. But you need at the start of the year, so you will invest it in year one.
Got it.
29,176. Okay. Then, for year three, it's 168,750, 7%. 875,000.
Is 118,125.
118. 1 to 5.
Yep.
Okay. Now, 509,60 was invested in year 0. And then we invested 29,176.
Minus 80,136.
Okay, how much? 50960 minus 29176. So it's 37989. I think you calculated wrong. Okay. 37989.
Yep.
Then 838800. Now, in this year, we need a reduction in working capital. So we will call it as a recovery because the sales have declined. 58716 minus 50960.
You can do minus 118.
Yeah, obviously I can do it. I can directly deduct this amount.
Yeah.
And 37989. So how much I need to extract from working capital? 29176 minus 37989. So 59,000.
Minus 4,09.
Now this will be a recovery of working capital because as the sales are expected to decline, so we will keep lesser amount in working capital.
Okay.
And the last assumption is the remaining amount invested in the working capital will be recovered in the last year. The entire amount which remained invested in the working capital will be recovered. Okay. How much is the amount invested? 50960 plus 29176. Plus 37989 minus 59409. So 58716 was the working capital invested amount. Okay. Now this is assumed to be recovered at the last year. 58716.
What do you do? You add them all up? Or could we recover them?
Basically, what we are doing is the entire amount capped as a working capital will be sold at the end of the project. Obviously, what we'll do if the project is ended, then what will we do of the surplus inventory? Okay. When we will close the project, we will sell the working capital amount. Okay. So what did I do is that this was the amount invested in the first year. This was invested in second year. This was invested in third year. And this was recovered in the fourth year. 58716. And obviously it is the last year working capital amount. You can obviously select it from there also. Okay.
Yeah.
So basically what you need to do is that you just need to revise your some basic knowledge.
Yeah. I need to look over these questions. Okay. I can just print this off. And I
can revise. So once you will solve them, you will automatically revise your old issues. So this is net cash flows. Okay. 1050960. Okay. 37,000 minus 11,100 plus 250,000 minus 29176. So this gives me 246,724. Okay. 193,610,58083 plus 250,000 minus 37989. So it's
453.
95750 minus 118725 plus 250 minus 59409. So it's 467,616. Okay.
Yep.
Now we will put the discount factor. the discount factor given was 12%. Okay. So we'll simply go and look at the discount factors of 12% in the discount factor sheet. So 12% discount factor, 0.89379771236. Okay. Okay, 0.893.
Yep.
The second one is 797. Then 712 and 0.636. Okay. So now we will get the present values.
2, 4, 6, 7, 2, 4, 0, 0, 0, 0.
Yes. Now what will be the present value?
220, 3, 2, 4.
Year one?
Yep.
220, 3, 2, 4. 3, 2, 4. Then 347,538 into 797. It's 270.
276,987.
Then 467,616 into 712. 332. 942.
And the last one is 224.
224,800. So what will be the NPV?
Yeah.
Sorry?
You'll deduct time from lesson for the stoppages, won't you?
Sorry?
You'll deduct time for, you know, all the stoppages in the lesson, in the stoppages? You know, when the class was stopping?
Yeah. Obviously, we will calculate on the basis of the recording. Recording is the net time we conduct the class. Don't worry about that. I'll not overbill you. I have taught you earlier also. I know you, bro.
you're the original, actually. Long time.
Yes. So the net present value is 4093. Okay. So if you look at it, now these all are the basic questions. Now these all are basically the preparation for the advanced question, because once you will go for foreign investment appraisal questions, they will be really difficult ones, because you have to convert the currencies, you have to charge tax of two countries, the double tax treaty issues. So in those questions, you have to be very fluent on these basic issues. If you will struggle in these basic issues, like if a student don't remember that, how you have to calculate the capital allowance or how you have to deal with increase in selling price and all that, it will be really difficult while teaching that. Okay. So basically, I have identified four questions for basic investment appraisal. The first one was Tricor company, in which we learned some basic techniques. Then we did SC company, in which we discussed incremental working capital technique. All was same except incremental working capital technique. Then there is a question of Pelta company. And then there is question of Dan company. This Dan company question, I usually ask the students to try it on their own so that they can have an idea. We will discuss one last question of this basic NPV technique. And then from the next meeting, we'll move towards APV, adjusted present value. And then we'll move towards foreign investment appraisal. Okay. So we'll try to complete each appraisal technique in one class.
Okay.
So let's look at one more question. The directors of Pelta company are considering a planned investment project costing $25 million payable at the first year of operation. The following information relates to the investment project. Sales volume 520, 624, 717, and 778. Selling price dollars per unit 30, 30, 30. Variable cost 10, 10.2, 10.61, and 10.93. Now this question is also.
they give us this already ready-made. Incremental.
No. We have to put inflation impact also. Now, this question is a good learning. You need to understand it first. Now, these are the fixed costs, 700, 735, 779, and 841. Now, these increases, given in the variable cost and fixed cost, are due to other factors. The inflation impact is other than that.
Okay.
Now, listen, the information needs adjusting to take account of selling price inflation of 4% and variable cost inflation of 3%. Now, this means that 10 to 10.2 do not include the impact of inflation. We have to put the impact of inflation separately. 10.2 is the uninflated value. Now, this will be a good learning that how you have to inflate this 10.2, because now you have to use the concept of power. But when I'll be calculating it, then I'll teach you the fixed costs, which are incremental and related to investment project, are in nominal terms. Fixed cost is already inflated. Nominal means inflated.
Yeah.
Okay. The year four sales volume is expected to continue for the foreseeable future. Pelta company pays tax at 30% 1 year in arrears. The company claimed tax allowable depreciation on 25% reducing balance basis. The views of the directors of Pelta company are that all investment projects must be evaluated over 4 years. Now, this is also very important. If you read this, the year's four sales will continue for the foreseeable future, which means they will continue for perpetuity. Please listen it.
Year four sales
are expected to continue for foreseeable future, which means perpetuity. But read this, what the director says. The director says that they want to evaluate only 4 years. The project will continue till the perpetuity, but the directors only evaluate it till the 4 years. So we will not consider perpetuity. We will only consider till 4 years.
Right, got it.
Okay, we have to listen to what the directors are saying. Okay.
Yeah.
With an assumed terminal value at the end of the fourth year of 5% of the initial investment cost, terminal value will be the scrap value. Both net present value and discounted payback must be used. Maximum discounted payback is 2 years. The real cost of capital is 7% and nominal cost of capital is 12%. So we will use this nominal cost of capital, not the real cost of capital.
Nominal, okay. Obviously has inflation.
Now, let's look at it. Now, what are the learnings in this question? Pelta company. The project appraisal will be for 4 years. Net present value. Okay. Year zero, year one, year two, year three, and year four. Now, and I think the tax is payable in arrears, if I'm not wrong. Yes, the tax is payable in arrears. So if the tax is payable in arrears, then I have to make one more year for the last year tax. Now, first of all, I will put the sales. Now, listen it very carefully that how I will calculate the sales. There are 5,20,000 units. The selling price is $30 in year one. And the inflation rate is 4% per year. So for the first year, I will inflate it one time, $5,20,000. $5,20,000 units multiplied by $30. What I can do is, I can make a selling price. Just a minute, a schedule on the site, because otherwise the things will get. Now, just workings, year one, year two, year three, year four, selling price, $30 into one plus the inflation rate, Now, please listen it very carefully. The inflation rate of selling price is 4%. So in case of selling price, I will charge inflation one time, power one. In year two, I will charge inflation two times.
Why are you doing this?
Now, basically why I'm doing this. Now, there are two methods of doing this. Like, for example, what you can do is you can simply 30 into 0.04. 30 into 1.04. So this will give me 31.2.
Yeah.
Now in selling price, as each year selling price is 30, 30, 30, 30.
Yeah.
You can do it like this way also, like you inflate it each year, like 31.2 into 1.04. Okay. But when you will be doing variable cost, listen it very carefully. When you will be doing variable cost, you will have a problem. Like year one variable cost is 10, but year two variable cost is 10.2. Okay. How will you inflate 10.2 two times? So you have to use the concept of power. Okay. Are you getting it? Now, basically, this 10.61 will get inflated three times. This 10.93 will get inflated four times. The variable cost inflation is 3% per year. Okay, so that's why you have to use the concept of power. Right. Now, in case of selling price, if you wouldn't have used the concept of power, then also it will work, because selling price was $30 for each year. Hmm. 32.448 into 1.04 power 1. It was 31.2. Yeah. Power 2, 32.4. 33.7. Yep. And then bedtime? It's... Sorry?
When's your bedtime?
My bedtime is have got delayed due to you. One plus 4% power 4. Okay, now if I talk about variable cost, 10, 10.20, 10.61, and 10.93.
Yep.
So each year variable cost amount is changing.
Yep.
10.2, 10.61, and 10.93. Now the variable cost inflation rate is?
It's
3% per year.
3%.
Now what you need to do is?
Same thing. Power.
1 plus 3% power 1. 1 plus 3% power 2. 1 plus 3% power 3 and 1 plus 3% power 4.
Yeah.
Okay. So 10 into 1.03, it's $10.3.
Yeah, 2 is 10.8.
Eleven point five nine, and 12.3. Okay, so this was a new issue in this, that we have to deal with different cost and then we have to inflate them.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, the number of units are 520. 624, 717, and 788. So 520,000 units multiplied by $31.2 was the first year selling price. then 6,24,000 units, multiplied by $32.4 selling price, then 7,17,000 units, multiplied by 33.74.
Yep.
And then 7,88,000 units multiplied by 35.09.
Yep.
Okay. So what will be my sales?
This is good software, isn't it?
This is a software and iPad, good notes. Its name is also good. 520,000. Now this COVID has made us expert of this software because the whole day we have to teach on iPad.
Yeah.
Last week my iPad suddenly got the LCD of the software went wrong.
Really?
So Sir Mustafa is coming back from America.
He's selling some stuff, isn't he?
No, he's in America, so he's recovering his ticket amount by selling the iPads he has purchased there.
I saw on his Snapchat.
Yeah, he's recovering his ticket amount.
Yeah.
624 into 32.4, 2021.
Yeah, 4.
7600. Yeah, what's the for amount?
2765.
2765.
0920.
0920.
Yeah.
And then 33.74. So this gives me 2419 1580. Okay. So then we will have variable cost. Okay, so I think that then again it will be a clerical work. You just need to multiply it. Okay, now rest of the question, if you look at it, once you are done with variable cost, you will simply put the fixed cost amounts.
Yep.
Okay, on fixed cost there is no inflation element because it is already in nominal terms.
Yeah.
Okay, depreciation is 25% reducing balance, and tax will be paid 1 year in arrears.
Okay.
So what do you think, you'll be able to do it?
I should be able to do this, yeah.
Or you want me to do complete it? What do you say?
I can probably try do it. I'll give it a go myself.
Because now I think it's a clerical work.
Yeah.
Okay. And one more question which you need to do is Dawn Company. And Dawn Company, I'll just help you out some basic issues. There is market research cost of $2,00,000. It's sunk cost, ignore it. Don't consider it your appraisal, because either you start the project or not, your market research cost is wasted.
Yeah.
Okay. The sales revenue, the cost. Okay. You have to again consider the impact of inflation rate. You have to use the concept of power.
Yeah. Okay. The same.
Because the amounts are changing. So you have to use the concept of power for inflated cash flows.
Yeah.
The investment amount, 2 million. The investment will have zero scrap value. Working capital investment is 10% of sales revenue. So you have to use incremental working capital technique.
Yeah. What we did.
Capital allowances will be 25% RDB, reducing balance. We have did it. Okay. Mm-hmm. Then tax rate, nominal discount factor. Tax is 1 year.
Just one question on nominal, on the discount factor stuff. Yeah. Where it's not...
Given real interest rate. We were given real inflation rate, a real discount rate, real cost of capital. So then we included the impact of inflation in it to convert it into nominal. In rest of the two questions, we were given with nominal rate.
So when it's nominal, then we don't have to do anything.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, got it.
So you have two questions as homework. One is Darn Company, you have to do it completely, and one is Palta, you have to complete it. Okay.
Can you send me this?
Or? Yeah, I'll send it in a while. I'll upload it. I'll upload it in the Google Drive folder. I think you must have got the link of the Drive folder.
I haven't got the link. No.
Why do? I sent you in the previous class. If you check your Gmail. archand@googlemail.com. You haven't got them?
No, the email is archand165@googlemail.com. Yeah, archand165, yeah?
I sent it. I'll send it again. So you'll get the folder link. I've uploaded the last class also in it. In every class, the folder will get automatically updated.
Okay. Please send it.
So today we have done the first investment appraisal technique, that is NPV. Majorly, it was a revision of your previous studies. In the next class, we will do one difficult technique. Now, that will be one which you need to study a bit, adjusted present value, because usually the students have forgotten it because it involves some advanced workings. Okay. Then after adjusted present value, I will put foreign cash flows, the foreign project appraisals. That will also be a bit difficult one. Then IRR, payback, and ROS will be easy adjustments. Okay. So in the next class, we'll do adjusted present value. Like again, we'll do 2-3 questions of adjusted present value, and I'll give you one question as a homework.
Okay. Can you send me the link for the Google Drive, please?
Yeah, I'll send you after the class.
Lesson tomorrow, yeah?
Yeah, daily we have to do lessons. Okay. Thanks. So tomorrow also we'll try it. Tomorrow we can conduct at 10 p.m. and we can also conduct it 1 hour earlier if you are available.
I'm available 1 hour earlier. That's fine.
So we'll do it at 9 p.m. My time and your time will be 5.
Yep, okay. Got it. Thank you. Bye-bye.